All right, I have the pleasure of introducing our next panel on the role of universities in reducing food waste. To moderate the panel, I'd like to welcome Dr. Douglas Palmer. Dr. Palmer currently serves as the Vice President for Academic Affairs and Provost, as well as Dean of Walsh University. Prior to this, Dr. Palmer was the Assistant Dean of Academic Innovation and an Associate Professor of History. In 2004, he was a research fellow at the Emory University School of Law, and he holds a PhD from The Ohio State University. In 2001, Dr. Palmer was a Fulbright Scholar in Utrecht, the Netherlands. Most importantly, it was Dr. Palmer's vision for Walsh University to become active in the fight against hunger. Dr. Palmer is the founder of a global studies program that addresses food, hunger, and sustainability. He also brought the first Ohio Hunger Dialogues to our state and our campus. And it is his commitment to this issue that has brought PUSH and the Summit Squared Conference here this weekend. Please welcome Dr. Palmer.
Thank you, Rachel. Really, my role in bringing PUSH here was that I raised my hand a year ago in Columbia, and I said, sure, we'll host. This seems like a great idea. So here we are. I want to welcome everyone to Ohio. I was thinking when Jamie was talking about the apps, the weather apps and the modeling and the open data that goes into it. Well, Ohio is actually where weather models go to die. So it's, I don't know, it's 45 degrees today, it's going to be 65 tomorrow. We have all four seasons in Ohio. Usually we have them all in 1 week. I was also struck by the conversation earlier today about open data and the role of research, and I didn't get a chance to ask my question, but I have the benefit of a bullet point today. And that part of the theme of this conference, and part of what we've discussed, is what are the roles of smaller liberal arts colleges in being able to do this? After all, we aren't producing a lot of research that is going to contribute to the open data that goes on out there, and I have sort of resigned myself to the fact that I'm not going to be the one who will solve hunger. But I just might have a student who might be the one who does that. And I think in the conversation about data and research and the need to have a multidisciplinary and an interdisciplinary perspective, well, Ty, you're speaking the language of the liberal arts institution, and so I would just simply, maybe as a challenge, say to our land-grant and public university fellows that our graduates are your future graduate students and researchers, and I would hope that one of the things that could come out of this might be some partnerships, some intentional partnerships, that would incentivize undergraduate students to take seriously the pursuit of agriculture and food security and nutrition research and find opportunities for our graduates of our biology and our chemistry and our nursing programs to take seriously the research role of the land-grant institutions. We will be happy to provide many fine and well-trained undergraduates to your graduate programs. And so please feel free to put your scholarship dollars at our disposal. We will spend it wisely. But today is also about the role of the university in reducing food waste, and so it gives me great pleasure to introduce our panelists. Our first panelist is Laura Belazis. Laura graduated from the University of Virginia and then earned a Master's of Public Health degree at Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health. Her master's degree focused on social determinants of health and evaluation methodology to address community health issues. Prior to joining the Campus Kitchen Project, where she now works, Ms. Belazis gained experience working with several nonprofits in addition to teaching biology as a Peace Corps volunteer in Mozambique. So the Peace Corps has been well represented here today. In her free time, she enjoys hiking, rock climbing, reading, cooking, and eating delicious things. That's what it says. Tyson Monagle is the marketing coordinator for the University of California Irvine's Department of Hospitality and Dining Services and Aramark. He coordinates marketing and sustainability programs for dining at UC Irvine. Mr. Monagle has worked on a variety of projects, including achieving zero waste in residential and retail dining locations, developing educational sustainability toolkits, and organizing programs such as the annual sustainability food fair. He also co-chairs the UC Sustainable Food Service Working Group and the UC Global Food Initiative's Zero Waste Dining Subcommittee. Mr. Tyson has a BA in English from UC Irvine, and so again, hooray for the liberal arts. Smith Lubow is a professional sustainability coordinator specializing in food sourcing, waste management, and marketing. As the Environmental Initiatives Coordinator for Cal Dining at UC Berkeley, Ms. Lubow specializes in sustainable food procurement and zero waste for four dining halls, four dining retail locations, and seven campus restaurants. With a goal of serving food at the intersection of delicious, nutritious, and sustainable. In addition to focusing on plant-forward cooking, is that right? I have no idea what that means. Ms. Lubow works with chefs to prioritize using ingredients that are locally grown, humanely treated, and environmentally and socially responsible. Before working for Cal Dining, she was the sustainability coordinator for UC Davis's dining service in partnership with Sodexo, heavily involved with the management and operations of the Davis Farmers Market, and privately contracted to manage zero waste events. Last on our panel, Ruthie Wofford is an Auburn University graduating senior majoring in political science with minors in hunger studies, philanthropy, and nonprofit studies, Spanish as well. In her spare time, what little I suppose she has, Ms. Wofford is the communications coordinator for the Hunger Solutions Institute and is the vice president of the Committee of 19, Auburn University's student leadership team for the War on Hunger, and the flagship chapter of universities fighting world hunger. After graduation, Ms. Wofford intends to pursue a career in food security and law. She was instrumental in creating the Rockefeller-sponsored Trash Hunger Non-Food Toolkit and Guide, providing a student's perspective to understanding the problem of food waste and defining activities to solve it. So welcome to our panel, and I will now invite Laura to please come up.
Introduction. Very nice to meet all of you. I look forward to talking with you all during the breaks, hopefully this evening, and those of you who are staying throughout the weekend for the upcoming summit. So I'm Laura Belazis, the Associate Director of the Campus Kitchens Project. Is anyone here familiar with Robert Egger? Show of hands, all right, a lot of people in the room. So Robert Egger founded DC Central Kitchen and then went on to found the Campus Kitchens Project. I promise I'll use less profanity than Robert would in these remarks. He has since gone on to found LA Kitchen, so he's gone to join our colleagues out west. So the Campus Kitchens Project has been around since 2001, and I will kind of dive into a little bit of our work. Can we get to advanced slides here? So this we talked about a lot on the last panel. You know, we are here because at the same time that 49 million Americans go hungry or don't know where their meal is going to come from every day, we throw out 40% of our food. So these are two crazy ideas. And that really are irreconcilable, and we need to bring these together to create effective solutions. We use the EPA's GREAT model in thinking about food recovery and thinking about food waste. And so they've put together this GREAT model, if you're not familiar with it. You know, source reduction at the top is the most preferred, followed by feeding 100 people. So that is what we do at the Campus Kitchens Project. Though a lot of our work then kind of rolls up into source reduction as people learn about the food waste that's going on. And there are three things that we do. So the first is using existing assets. On all of your campuses, there are incredible assets. And we try not to think about the problems in a community. We try to think about the assets and the opportunities. You have commercial kitchens that are state-of-the-art on your campuses, whether it's dining or catering or a nutrition and dietetics department that aren't being used after hours on the weekends. You have food in your dining halls, in your supermarkets, in your restaurants that's perfectly good, but not needed and thrown away. You have students who are passionate and have so much knowledge and enthusiasm and who are ready to take action in their communities. So we leverage all of these resources to recover food that would otherwise go to waste and create balanced meals so that we can feed hungry people. And then the second core value is going beyond the meal, thinking about not just the problem today, but what can we do tomorrow to create sustainable solutions so that we're not just putting food in the hands of someone now, but thinking about how that they can obtain meals in the future and create a self-sustaining model. And then finally, the future, the people who are actually going to solve this problem for us are our student leaders, and giving them the tools, the resources, the opportunity to take action on these issues. These students are hungry for really tangible leadership opportunities. And we are really delighted that we're able to provide them with opportunities for really meaningful service during their undergraduate and graduate careers. We find that the students who volunteer in a leadership role with us, they tell us that after their experience, they, 100% of them tell us that they contributed in a valuable way to their community. That, 95% of them said they are more confident in their leadership skills. 98%, they identify the people they serve. So they're building that empathy and that connection to the community. We often hear from students that through these programs, they break down the kind of campus and community bubble that sometimes exists, and they cross those bridges. And then, what I think a lot of parents like, is 92% of them tell us that they feel more likely to get a job after they graduate. And we don't care what career they go into after they graduate, but I think they take with them this idea that service is important, that serving their communities is important. And we hear from our students, I always knew I wanted to be a doctor, but now I know that I need to think about hunger as a health issue. I always knew that I wanted to be a lawyer, but now I want to be a community advocate. Or sometimes we hear, oh, I was going to go to business school, but instead I'm going to join Teach for America, and then I'm going to start my own nonprofit. Maybe not what their parents were envisioning, but I think still a great success. So with this work, one way that we like to reframe the idea of food recovery and distributing food is in terms of providing balanced meals. So our campus kitchens don't just, recover 100 pounds of bagels and then redeliver them. They bring food back to a central kitchen and make sure that there are starches, proteins, fruits and vegetables, so that you're creating a balanced meal and really serving people in the community in a respectful and dignified way. If you have a community that suffers from obesity or diabetes, just redelivering food that in the way that you receive it isn't always the best service to that community. So we think really deliberately about health and nutrition and the collaborations with departments on those campuses to make sure that the assistance we're providing really is serving people. So you can see Kendra from University of Kentucky there. I know he's some Kentucky folks in the audience. She'll be speaking later this week as well. I talked about going beyond the meal, because food is really a tool. Food is something that everyone can talk about. I know I can talk about food for a long time. And it's an opportunity to build communities and build relationships so that if you're delivering a meal to a senior center, maybe you can then create a program fighting senior isolation, which is a major cause of senior hunger. Maybe if you're delivering food to an after-school program, you can then partner to do nutrition education. If you're working with another senior community or an adult program, you can do a cooking class or a gardening program. And all of these are building those sustainable solutions to hunger and food waste. If anyone is interested, feel free to check out our website. We have some great online planning tools for students, and we do have startup grants as well. Always helps to start off a little bit of money.
Start. Okay, perfect.
Yeah, he's switching.
So while that's getting taken care of, I just want to go ahead and just kind of reintroduce myself briefly. So I am Tyson from UC Irvine, and I, I think the question came up. Sam mentioned she's talked to some people, and the question came up, right? How do you, work on some of these issues if your campus, contracts with a food service provider, that sort of thing? So it was mentioned in my introduction, but I just want to reiterate, I do work directly with Aramark, and we're contracted by UC Irvine. So I can help kind of give that perspective as well. What can be done when you're working with a contracted food service provider?
I'm Sam Lubow. I work for Cal Dining, which is a self-operated dining facility at UC Berkeley, and we do about 30,000 meals a day. So food waste is a problem when you're serving that many meals, and I'm hoping to showcase some of the ways that we're reducing food waste and also allocating it to people in need.
So we'll go ahead and dive right in. I want to talk about, of course, one of the big themes is data. So I want to talk about a couple of data tools and solutions that are available through UC Irvine, through the UC Global Food Initiative, and through other parts of UC as well. So going in first, one of the things I want to talk about before we get to the tools is the idea of waste characterizations. When we talk about waste, one of the things that is really important is looking beyond just the idea that, okay, there's compost, there's recycle, there's landfill, but really what is comprising your waste stream? As we look to reduce waste, we have to better understand what it is that we have in our facilities, particularly our dining facilities. So here you can see, this is an example from UC Merced where they conducted a 24-hour complete assessment of all waste that came through their Yellow Cuff Wallace Dining Center back in February of last year. And I don't know if it's visible from where you're all sitting. I know it's a little hard even on my eyes. But by far the largest chunk, of course, is food waste. But you can see in there, there's a couple different categories when you get into the gray, which is the landfill. And as you see, we have a goal of 95% or more solid waste diversion from landfills. Well, if you're looking at the numbers there, you can see that's actually about 8 or 9% of the waste is landfill-only materials. So based on that, they can look at their waste stream and they say, even if everybody sorted everything completely perfectly, they wouldn't get to zero waste. So I have to make some changes. And so I think that's one of the things that I want to drive home in some of the tools that are available is really looking at what changes we have to make as operators, as administrators, not just the student education that many of us talk about. The next part here I want to talk about, though, is once we've made some of those changes and we think we're on track to zero waste, how do we assess that? How do we really make sure then we're getting all of our waste in the proper end use, whether that's to be recycled or to be composted, to be anaerobically digested, whatever that case may be. As part of the UC Global Food Initiative, I had the opportunity to work with fellows at UC Merced, as well as dining administrators all throughout UC, to really examine our waste streams. And we put together a calculator that is available through the UC Global Food Initiative. It uses EPA conversion factors. Very simple to use. You plug in the size of a bin and how full it is with the correct type of waste. And you can also mark, of course, if it's intended to be a recycling bin, but it's clearly contaminated as you're inspecting that bin, you're gonna mark it as a landfill bin instead of recycling. And based on those weights that you provide in there, or those volumetric estimates that you provide in there, it'll tell you how much of your waste you're actually diverting from landfills. So just a very simple tool to use, but very useful as we track our progress in terms of reducing waste.
In terms of data, I wanted to highlight how we're using our menu management system, which is eCheck. So we have physical logs in all of our locations, and we train all of our employees. If you're going to put it in a compost bin, it's got to go on that log first. Those logs are entered into eCheck, and eCheck updates the data in real time on how much we're spending on food, so we can get accurate estimates of how much money we're wasting with our food waste, and then we can go back and look at how we can adjust our production and adjust our forecasting so that we can produce less food waste in the first place. And I didn't mention this earlier, but we are going to go through a lot of examples of different things at UC campuses, having worked for Davis and Berkeley. A lot of the examples are from Davis, Berkeley, and Irvine, but we've also reached out to our counterparts at the UCs like San Diego to see what we could highlight from them as well. The Weigh Your Waste program is something that happens on quite a few campuses, and UCI's graph, it does help reduce post-consumer waste. So this is waste that was brought back to the dish return. This is really useful in all you care to eat dining halls because it helps us measure post-consumer waste and provides education to the students. So instead of me trying to explain what that looks like, our students put together a video and I wanted to show you that.
Strategies that have worked here and haven't worked in conjunction with those type of events, the wager waste or wiping on waste or whatever it may be called at your campus or at whichever you see. So all of these four here, as well as one other thing, have all been tried at UC Irvine, and I'll go through them just very briefly. So the first one here, we called it guess the waste. So we were calling our event waste before, so this was guess the waste. You know, everything kind of plays on that theme. So guess the waste. We had people as they were coming up, not necessarily a full survey, but filling out how much do they think at the end of the evening it's all going to weigh? And a little comment field, why? To get them to think, maybe I can better understand what is causing food waste, but at the same time also, maybe they're putting in that comment, I didn't enjoy such and such, and we're learning from that. We're able to take a look at our recipes, take a look at our menus, and be able to adjust. That one was fairly successful, actually. So that's one that I can recommend. You should need to have a nice way to be able to staff it properly, the space for it, a way to collect those kind of comment cards, things like that. As a prize, I think we gave about like 25 FlexNine dollars or something like that for the person who guessed the closest, which is like the campus declining balance. Eat the waste, this is one that I would say probably skip. It's a good idea in theory. What we did was we set a target based on the previous year. And we said, okay, if you can get under that many ounces per person, we're gonna hold a bonus theme meal. The problem is it's such a delayed gratification. We're talking about holding a bonus theme meal in spring if they're doing, you know, this reduced food waste in fall and winter and, you know, early spring. And that's way too long for them to wait to see that reward. So, you know, the results were decent, but people actually forgot that we were even doing this competition. So, you know, kind of make of that what you will. The next one here, and there's a couple photos there from our Instagram. We call it Carry Your Waste. And what this was is, as we were doing this event, every half hour when we weigh the waste, we were adding to a backpack, we were adding scales to a backpack up to 30 pounds, because EH&S said that was the limit. Any heavier and, you know, you're in trouble. But we added, you know, as we went along, up to 30 pounds, some weights, and we invited people as they were, you know, coming up and engaging. We're saying, well, would you like to, you know, carry that, see how much that really weighs and feel that impact? And for the people that did it, they were completely blown away. The number of people that chose to take that step, though, was lower. So, again, you know, as you're evaluating, maybe thinking about what works at your campus, what doesn't, that's one where we had lower engagement, but a very high impact on people that engage. And finally, I wish I had included a photo of it here, actually. The last one, which we kind of stole the name from Sam's program at UC Davis and tweaked it just a little bit. Love your food, don't waste it. What we did is, in addition to, you know, kind of a boosting engagement with you know, kind of a prize bowl and things like that, is we put up a week-long can pyramid display with a very large sign, probably about this big or so, that said, on average, Americans waste 20 pounds of food per month, and, you know, had, I think, three or four tips on how you can reduce food waste. We did a post survey of how many people saw it, how many people, and this is, again, self-reported, but how many people felt that it changed their attitudes or awareness of food waste, and how many people felt, again, self-reported, that they had changed their behaviors or actions as a result of seeing that. The results were overwhelmingly very, very positive. So that's one. It took, you know, some time to put together. We collected a bunch of, you know, number 10 cans. We tried hot gluing them together. I don't recommend that. It turns out, as we did, the base was 7 cans wide. Turns out when it gets that long, it just kind of falls apart when you try carrying it. If you do them in groups of 2 or 3, that works, and then you can kind of, you know, make that work out as well. But very, very positive results out of that type of event. So, you know, we talked a little bit about, you know, measuring waste. Really, once, you know, you're measuring waste, the most important thing we can be doing is minimizing the waste that we're producing.
So I wanted to highlight a program that Danny started at UC Davis, the Try to Taste and Just Ask. So with Try to Taste, we have little sample cups at each of the platforms that students can try a taste of the dish before they grab a whole portion of that dish. Some students would go around and get little fufu platters and try everything before they decided what they wanted a whole portion of. And then Just Ask really gets the students to interact with our cooks behind the platform and customize their dish. So if that dish comes with a side of rice and you really don't want that side of rice and you probably are going to waste it, then you can just ask to go rice. This is something really fun we're doing at UC Berkeley, our Room to Leaf culinary strategy. So one of our cafes is the Showcase to Sustainability grounds, and we're trying to utilize the whole plant. So this is a picture of our broccoli stalk cilantro slaw. So we have a recipe that uses a ton of the florets from the broccoli, and we are getting a lot of stalks left in the compost. So now we're using those stalks, we're shredding them, and we're including it in the slaw. We also have a beet and beet green and goat cheese panini that we serve there, utilizing the beet green and the beets themselves.
So just briefly, I want to touch on this piece here, which is a UC initiative. It's the My Last Trash campaign. And so there are a number of different resources and subsites for the different UCs on this as well that I encourage people to check out and learn more. But basically what this is a 12-month toolkit that can be deployed by operators, you know, administrators at AUC for getting people to think about reducing their waste and getting to that point where we have that last piece of trash. So it's got different monthly themes, it's got different paraphernalia, things like that. You can see obviously there's some branded elements to kind of drive engagement, drive solidarity on the campuses, get people to realize that there is this culture around reducing waste. It starts out, I believe, January is kind of an intro to, you know, what this campaign is, right? Each year you can kind of have an intro to refresh. What is My Last Trash? From there, I believe it goes to paper waste. I think I might be getting that wrong. But anyway, you know, it's got a different focus each month as well, so that people can think about just one step at a time, how do we reduce this one type of thing? How do we eliminate waste from, you know, paper? How do we use less paper, or how do we make sure that the paper we do use is getting recycled rather than, you know, casually tossed in a landfill bin, or a bin that isn't marked and is getting, you know, contaminated and becoming a landfill bin? That type of thing as well. So certainly I recommend checking that out for some other resources and ideas for your own universities. We talked there about, you know, minimizing waste, reducing the waste that we generate. I want to talk about now diverting waste that is generated. So, Sam?
Yeah, we're really fortunate in California. We have a food bin system. We have access to recycling, composting, and landfills. So it's, when you have that much available to you, it also comes with a lot of training for our customers and our kitchen staff to make sure that they're sorting it correctly and reducing contamination. What we've done is started again at UC Davis, and we continue that at UC Berkeley. We have a waste sorting competition for our staff that handles all of the training. So twice a month, our sustainability students go through the back kitchens and grade their bins based on bin contamination, making sure the bins are sorted correctly into compost, recycling, and landfill. Bin location, making sure those compost bins and those landfill bins are right next to each other, because that is the key to success in getting them to sort their waste correctly. And then bin liners, making sure, and finally we're at a point where they're finally lining every bin correctly with compostable liners or the plastic liners. So twice a month they get a score, and then those scores are aggregated, and the unit or the dining hall with the highest score is our zero waste champion for the month. So they get presented a trophy, and then they're highlighted in our newsletter. And it's really been successful because it makes the managers keep their staff on top of things because they want that trophy and they want to be the zero waste champion.
Right, so we of course all want all of our facilities to have that culture and have that option. And I know it varies a lot regionally, right? Of course, you know, what is available off campus for waste. Sam mentioned we're very fortunate in California generally to have, you know, not only recycling facilities but either composting facilities or, you know, kind of another form of composting anaerobic digesters. That said though, even when you have those facilities available, part of this conversation on diverting waste has to be, and I just want to kind of take this opportunity, has to be talking with the people that run your waste programs and talking with the people that manage these facilities to make sure that all of the waste you have can actually, in fact, go through that process. One of the things that we've discovered at many UCs, including UC Irvine, is that some of the products that, you know, we were being told, not just from the manufacturer, but being told from people along this process, oh yeah, it's going through, it's being composted. When we followed up and we really hit every point along the chain, we were finding somebody say, yeah, no, we're taking that out. It's getting filtered. It's getting, so making sure that, you know, the products that we're using can be diverted if we have to have waste in the first place, but also looking at opportunities to reduce that waste, to eliminate a disposable clam shell container. So I think that's one of the areas, you know, maybe collectively we can all look at that as an action.
I think it's really hard not to talk about pre-consumer waste without talking about food donations. This is a huge topic on college campuses, especially the UC systems right now. Starting in November, we started to get a daily pickup from a company called Copia. Yes, we are paying a company to pick up our overproduction, but it's one of the most reliable situations we've found to have someone on our back dock daily. So we're donating all of our overproduction from the day with the exception of late night. And we found Topia provides us with data on how much overproduction they're picking up. And having that data right at our fingertips Yes, it was in eTech before, but getting that report regularly every week has helped us reduce our overproduction by 35%. In addition to Copia that handles our resident dining halls that have the majority of our food waste, we also work with the Student Parent Association to pick up our campus restaurant donations. We've identified student parents are probably some of the most neediest, or some of the families with the most need, and so we're really happy that we can provide them with a weekly pickup every Friday. And this is happening all over the UC, so a good example is at UC Davis. They've started a Food Recovery Network chapter. Food Recovery Network gets students to come together and volunteer to pick up their overproduction and bring it to local nonprofits, local shelters, or to their own food pantries.
So kind of getting towards our last leg here, because I understand we have Q&A is incredibly important in these. We talked a little bit about food access and security, mostly in the context of overproduction and what would be considered waste in a sense. But next we want to talk about some of the other programs for food access and security that don't necessarily deal with waste.
So we have point and swipe donation programs on a lot of our campuses. UCLA kind of started this Swipe Out Hunger and has helped other campuses with their own programs. At UC Berkeley, we use the meal points. We have a point donation system, so the students can donate their excess meal points, and we use those meal points to purchase groceries to stock our on-campus pantry. Other Swipe Out Hunger programs will take those swipes and work with their financial aid office to make sure that students without access to the dining hall could get that access by applying through the program. So I know UCLA, Santa Barbara, Davis all have situations similar to that.
And then one of the things, of course, that is incredibly valuable when you have food insecure populations on your campus and maybe you've already set up a food pantry or you set up another network is getting that food, that produce that's available through programs like Campus Farms and Gardens. So you can see here in the top left corner there, some students from the UC Davis Student Farm, which is a very robust program with the agriculture program at UC Davis. Also, students over at UC Berkeley growing food in the student garden there, which is then going to the food pantry. At the UC Davis one, for context, that goes, they have quite a bit because it's such a big student farm. They have food that's going not only to the food pantry, but also to the dining halls on the campus too. So students that aren't necessarily using that food insecurity are still benefiting from the environmental components of growing local food. And a number of other programs throughout the UC system as well that we just wanted to include some photos here because it's a great thing to do.
I really wanted to highlight a Fresh Focus at UC Davis. So in this program, there was a lot of food going to waste on the field. So people hadn't ordered it or it wasn't harvested for their CSA box. And students identified this and started to volunteer on the farm to harvest that produce. And then to be extra sustainable and environmental, they're bicycle delivering that produce to the pantry twice a week. Another program that was really innovative at UC Davis was the Fruit and Veggie Up program. So as you can imagine, grocery stores have a ton of produce waste. Every morning, the Nugget Markets was bleeding their produce because customers don't buy slightly blemished produce. So we partnered with Nugget to receive that produce, and we get student volunteers four times a week to go to Nugget and pick it up, and then it's offered at the Student Health and Wellness Center twice a week, and it's also offered at the pantry twice a week. So it's just another option for students on the campus to get access to fresh fruits and vegetables.
And then another option, again, kind of along the same lines, at UC Irvine, and I think we do have a video that I'll play. There's a monthly free farmers market for students.
Let's take a look. Wofford Farmers Market. It's a mobile or pop-up fresh produce distribution to increase access to fruits and vegetables for our students with limited budgets and need for nutritious food. The free farmers markets take place at Lower Gateway Plaza, which is the area between Langston Library and Gateway Study Center. We currently have a free farmers market once a month. As of now, we know that we will have a farmers market until April of this year, while we explore ways to offer produce on a more regular basis. These farmers markets were designed with students who have limited budgets in mind. So students who lack access, right, to nutritiously dense foods, or who just like are always finding themselves like there's, you know, the budget is not enough for food, especially for nutritious food, should definitely come out to the free farmers market so they can supplement their budget and also add more fruits and veggies to their diets.
So the program there, you see Irvine, when they started it, which was this past October, the first event, the kickoff event, they brought 4,000 pounds of produce that was provided by the UOC Food Bank. They've kept that going every month since, and as you mentioned, there was some uncertainty whether this would continue after April or not. It's been confirmed that it will. So it's a very popular program. I was sharing with some folks, I believe, at lunch, that the one in October, they ran out probably about halfway through the time they had scheduled. And students, you know, of course, were loving it, but they were also getting about 5 pounds of produce per person. So quite a bit, quite a substantial amount. But, you know, looking at the need that exists in the UC, it's not unreasonable, right? If we're looking at, you know, students at, you know, close to 40% facing some degree of food insecurity, we have to look at, you know, how do we get more, not how do we necessarily just ration it out.
At UCLA, Tyler was actually the one that started this program in which they're leaning, instead of playing the video, I can just talk about it. They're leaning produce from farmers markets, and so they're asking farmers to donate their excess produce that might have gone to waste to people in need, and they're doing deliveries of this produce, and you can see how much they get from these farmers markets to the Student Parent Center and to other local nonprofits and associations in need. So I can't speak as well about it as Tyler can, and so I'm sure he'll be available to answer questions about that program as well. And our move-out programs, I think, are really important to highlight. Several of the campuses, including UC San Diego and UC Davis, have pretty extensive move-out programs that collect non-perishable food donations, clothing donations, anything that could be reused, and they're sending it to Goodwill, to the on-campus pantries, and to the on-campus reuse stores.
So thank you for your time. We're looking forward to the Q&A.
Before we go on to Ruthie, it's always been my habit that when one makes a mistake, that one has to own it. Yes, that was my cell phone that went off during your talk. My apologies. But the teachable moment is I saw a lot of you checking to make sure your cell phone was silent. So, right, it all worked out okay. Ruthie, thank you.
My name is Ruthie. I'm a senior. I'm going to be graduating in May from Auburn University, which is very exciting, kind of a long time coming, but also terrifying. So, and I know that we've heard a lot of information today. I think every single speaker that we've heard today has been extremely inspiring and very interesting, and all very different, which I've really appreciated the diversity of the people who are representing their nonprofits, organizations, and schools. So it's really great to hear from you guys. And so I'm here today to provide more of a student perspective. I've heard so many great stories about programs being implemented for students. And so now I'm going to give you sort of the student perspective of that. But I'm going to kind of tell it in a narrative fashion, just to kind of change things up a bit. But essentially, I came to Auburn University. I've lived in Alabama my entire life. So I went to high school about 2 hours north of Auburn, so I haven't moved very far yet. But I came into Auburn having absolutely no idea what I want to do, other than generally something sort of non-profit-y, just helping people, you know, very vague. And I added the nonprofit minor, which is a really neat opportunity, very unique. And I'm very glad I had it at Auburn. And I took the intro to hunger studies class, just kind of taking it to get, you know, this credit. And Kara Newby, who's back there in the corner, really, it was a huge impact on my life. Because for the first time ever, I realized how big of a problem food insecurity is. I didn't know the term food insecurity before your class. And so it started me on this journey of kind of learning more about hunger and how it's approached nationally, internationally, locally. And I ended up adding the minor, and Kate Thornton, who's back there, is in charge of the minor, the hunger studies minor. And so last semester I took her class, the hunger studies capstone. And as a class, there were about 10 of us, and we knew that we had a massive legacy to fulfill, because in the past, Kate's capstone classes have done things like start a Canvas Kitchens chapter in Auburn. They've worked directly for the World Food Program and presented data in Rome, which is awesome. Super jealous. Last year, they began a program called Living the Creed. Auburn has a creed that basically highlights the things that are important to Auburn, and among those is being able to support yourself through hard work. And this class realized that there are many, many hardworking staff members at Auburn, but not all of them were receiving a living wage as per Alabama cost of living. And so they began this journey of basically lobbying our administration to pay these people and have raised their minimum wage, which was not easy, as you can imagine. That's a big ask. But really, none of these projects, Living the Creed, Canvas Kitchens, all of the other things that they've done, none of that would have been possible had it not been for a healthy relationship with the Auburn University administration. And so that's why I'm kind of here today, is to encourage you guys, as the administration, most of you are, to really work with students, because we have a unique perspective because of the time of life that we're in. We have a unique perspective, and we're able to potentially add a lot. So when I came to the capstone class, we realized that we wanted to look more internally about hunger within Auburn University, and we found the University of California study, which Danny just talked to us about, and we were floored that hunger was that prominent. We also found a Feeding America statistic that states that 10% of the food bank recipients that Feeding America is over, which is most food banks, 10% of those recipients are full-time students. And we were shocked. Where are these students? Who are these students? We didn't know. Auburn University is a public land grant institution, and it is a relatively affluent school. I think we have about 12% of students that qualify for Pell Grants. It's very low. So we assumed that hunger was not that big of an issue. But we decided to check anyway, because why not? And we found a graduate student in Auburn who was looking at this very issue, and she was creating a quantitative study to assess food insecurity, and she too was using the USDA survey. And instead of using the 6-question survey like the University of California did, they were using the 10-question survey. And that categorizes people into 4 categories instead of 3. And so basically it's very food secure, moderately food secure, low food security, and very low food security. And we've partnered with this graduate student, and what we found was shocking. And so of these 17,000 junior, seniors, and graduate students surveyed through this 10-question survey, we found that 31% of them, the people who responded, qualify as either low food security or very low food security, which was shocking. And so our next step was to do a qualitative study of who these people are, why are they hungry, what are their coping strategies, and that was even more shocking. So we began a series of interviews with students, and this was with the help of Kate Thornton. This was almost entirely student-run. And so we worked with the IRB, we got it approved, and we did these interviews, and it was life-changing. I sat in on a number of these interviews and transcribed a lot of them. And the coping mechanisms were honestly horrifying. And the people, some of the people interviewed were my classmates, who I didn't know very well, but I just recognized them in class. I've talked to students who are mixing flour and rice together to fill themselves up. I've talked to students that are mixing sugar and water together just to stay awake through class because they're so tired because they don't have any food to give them energy. I've talked to students who are recovering from eating disorders but can't fully recover because they can't afford food. And so it's just, it's really, really sad. And then there's a lot of other more typical, stereotypical student hunger situations where all they're eating is ramen, or they're going grocery shopping every 2 months. And these are people just like me, from the same background, same major, same classes, but these people are not eating nearly enough food to be productive, and especially productive students, and academically successful. And so once we collected this data, we knew we had to have the data to be able to go to the Auburn administration and say, we've got to fix this. Because as you know, numbers speak volumes, and you can't, you know, have this massive budget reversal if you don't have numbers to back you up. So we knew that the administration would want that. So we got an interview with the university president, as well as some very, very high profile administrators. And that was a week and a half ago, something like that. It was very recent. And it was very successful. They were very open to hearing what we had to say. And it wasn't that we don't have infrastructure to help these students because no one cares about them. It's because we didn't know. And so now we are, you know, our goal would be to be like University of California and all these great programs that we just heard about from you guys. But we don't really have anything as of yet. We have a food pantry, a student food pantry that is donation based. There's no funding. They can only support about 8 students a week. And with our 31% statistic, we know that there's way more than that. And so we want to be able to make permanent changes, institutional changes, so that students have these resources. And so we're working with our administration right now, and hopefully very soon we'll be able to have some permanent goals that we can reach towards, and hopefully, I would love to see a fully funded campus food pantry with many, many more students, hopefully within the next year. And I'm graduating, but there's a whole other bunch of students from our research class, and Kate is there, and the Committee of 19 and Campus Kitchens, who will be fighting for that as well. So that's good to know, very comforting. So as a result of this, I, as a student, have felt extremely empowered, and it has given me so much confidence. If you had told me that I was going to be up here with you all 2 years ago, I would have laughed at you and then walked away. So it's been incredible, especially to work with the Hunger Solutions Institute and Paula and all of you. So I would definitely encourage you to reach out to students, have them do your research for you if you need to, because they're willing to do it. And I would like to encourage you to definitely assess food security on your campus if you haven't already. As has been stated, there are ongoing or potential research programs happening. But if your school does not have plans to do that, please look into it. We would love to partner with you and help you alongside that. But we didn't think we had really any problem with hunger. And we absolutely do. So if that is your case, I would just really encourage you to look into that. Additionally, I would just encourage you, kind of like I said earlier, to use students as resources. We are energetic, and we are not tied down by a 9-to-5, and we're just very passionate, as you all know. And so use us as resources. We want to help. And so that's all I've got for right now, and I'll wait for questions. But yeah, thank you guys so much.
I was actually tempted to start with a sort of flippant remark about students armed with data marching into administrators' offices, but I actually think there's a fairly important point here, and that's, and maybe even with Tyson, what we talked about in the previous session, Andre, I think of you, right? And that really the answer is, right, data is power, and those who control the data have the ability to help shape the narrative. And I think Ruthie's comments helps to underscore the importance of having open data so that those who need it can use it. It's not just being controlled by governments or states or other groups as well. So I will withhold my joke and say congratulations on your efforts. As we get into the Q&A, I thought maybe we could just start out and talk and hear from the audience what are some of the other efforts that might be happening on some of your campuses.
So Alex Bryan, UM Sustainable Food Program at the University of Michigan, program manager. So we are doing very similar things to the UC system when it comes to food waste production, either through Food Recovery Network, we do pre and post consumer compost in all of our dining halls and our retail locations, which we go over to compost materials and their composting off-site. Started Campus Farm in 2012. That was actually a student-led initiative. As is the UM Sustainable Food Program, which is a coalition of about a dozen member groups in sustainable food broadly. One of them is a student-run food pantry, another is a recovery network, others work at the campus farm, volunteer in those spaces. And so I'd say echoing a lot of what I heard at the UC system happening at the University of Michigan, but just beginning to really dive into that food insecurity question and issue. Similarly to Auburn, Michigan has a very low Pell Grant usage and tends to be sort of seen as a very affluent university. Even within the administration, there can be some denial to sort of issues, which is unfortunate. Going recently to our food distribution and seeing a line of 100 students for over an hour to wait to carry two or three big bags of heavy groceries from a very far off-campus location, 20-30 minute walk. It echoes back to the work I was doing before coming to the University of Michigan in food banking and sort of food insecurity, food hunger issues in those regards. And so, just sharing a little bit of what we're up to and we'll be happy to talk with other folks too. And excited to be here. Thank you.
Hi, everyone. Again, my name is Kristen. I'm the new kid on the block. I've worked in Fraternity and Sorority Life for the last 10 years, and this past August, I walked into my office after being married, and they said, hey, you're gonna work on food insecurity initiatives for the area. So we have changed things up significantly. I'm at the State University of New York at Buffalo State, and recently, SUNY, our 64 campuses and research centers have been doing surveys of all of the campuses to see what is best practice in our area. So, we seem to be leading the way, which is weird because, again, I started this in August. But what we've done is we've created a first-time applicant form for our students for online usage that has data as far as the eyes can see. We have every single, meal swipe card program, whether they're commuter, it ranks from the very high one to the very low one. We ask if they live at home, we ask if they live on campus, we ask if they rent. You name it, we have the data. From there, what we did is we have our dietetics crew come into our office and they assist us with the inventory of our food pantry. Most of our food pantry is donation as well. It comes from the Keough Memorial Food March, which is done through the Veterans Association. So those volunteers in the Buffalo area that decide to wear a 50-pound rucksack full of food, we get all of that, we separate that, we look at expiration dates, and then we create an inventory that becomes an online shopping list for our students. So now students don't have to feel embarrassed to visit any of our locations. If they don't, what they do is they do their online shopping that correlates with the inventory that our students do in dietetics, and a bag is prepared for them within 24 hours. All they have to do is stop up to my office in the Student Life office and say, hey, I'm here for my pickup. And my staff is automatically trained to say, great, what's your name? We'll be happy to help you. Take a seat with you within 2 seconds. They grab the bags, they're allowed two full bags of groceries per week, and off they go. We also have 9 supplemental satellite stations where they can grab like a hot microwave meal before class. So those are available, but SUNY best practice has been that most of them are one location on campus. There's one other campus that has a mobile food truck that comes in of sorts, so they can stop there. And one other one has two locations on campus. So we're moving and grooving. I'm looking forward to learning from you all, but we're really trying to make it as complimentary to our students as possible. We also changed the dynamic of my office, so there's more couches, there's a chandelier, like, not fancy at all, it's from Urban Outfitters. Their food is around, bless you. So they can come in and chill. We talked to the administrators on campus, there's 80 student affairs professionals on my campus that say you can trust Kristen, walk in there, she will explain the SNAP benefits with you. We've taken a survey of all the locations in Buffalo that either have free clothing, free food, free social services, and we wrote them and broke them down into male, female resources, all of that jazz, so they can also see those supplemental things. So this is just from August, so we'll get better, but thank you for your help. I appreciate your ideas.
Maybe one more example, then we can go to some questions, too.
Yeah, hi.
Hold the button on the bottom. Yes, until the screen turns blue.
Can you hear me? Okay. My name is Chris Partridge. I'm at the University of Nevada, Reno. I'll make it kind of quick because we're doing some of the same stuff that others are doing. We've had a pantry on our campus for probably a couple of decades now, and it's gone through some reiterations. And we recently rebranded it to try and appeal more to students, I guess. So one of the issues we're seeing, and I'm kind of curious if anyone else is seeing it, especially after hearing about the robust system they have in the UC system, is students not necessarily using the resource even though it's there. Because we have data that says how many students are identifying as experiencing food insecurity on campus, but we're not serving anywhere near that many students. So I'm kind of looking at this, whether there's a culture of students just accepting the fact that they're not going to eat while they're going to school, this whole starving college student stereotype, or if there are other issues that might be preventing that. So our program is not nearly as inclusive or as comprehensive as what you showed at Cal, but I'd be curious to hear what others think.
Thank you.
Yeah, and if I could just say a few words addressing that, as far as the campus culture of not using a food pantry even if you have access to it, things like that. We have run into that a lot. We said, hey, we know your food is secure after these interviews. Have you thought about using the food pantry? And they say, oh no, I don't deserve that. I'm not hungry enough. It's very comparison-based, at least in Auburn. And there's also a lot of shame that goes into it, and you had that online shopping. I think that's so innovative, and that's awesome. And I hope that we can do that at some point. But yeah, there's a lot of shame in asking for help. We've had a lot of students that we've interviewed that don't even ask their parents. Like, their parents don't even know that they're food insecure because they don't want to ask for help. Because either they're ashamed or they feel bad. There's a lot of guilt that goes into it. And so it kind of goes back to, you need that qualitative data. You need to know why students are acting the way they are. Why are they throwing away food? Why are they not using food pantries in order to fix it? Yeah.
Danny will have a good response to this too. But on our campus, our food pantry just recently moved from a location across the street from the student union to the student union, and it's tripled in usage. So I can't speak to why they weren't using it before, but having that really centrally located, they can't keep up anymore. It's tripled in use. And Danny?
Sure, so we did survey our students about, they knew about the resources available on campus and whether or not they were using them. So overall, all the students, regardless of whether or not they were food insecure, 55% responded that they knew the location of the food pantry on campus, but they didn't think they needed it. So of our food insecure population, 37% reported that they didn't receive information about the pantry on campus and didn't need it, and over 45% said that they didn't receive the information but would like it. So that shows us that we were not doing a good enough job across the system to communicate to the students that there was even this resource available. And we even assessed whether or not we knew that there were federal resources available, like SNAP. And of that, of our food insecure population, 50% of the students responded that they didn't receive this information but felt they didn't need the federal funds. And 37% of our food insecure population said that they didn't receive information that SNAP was eligible, but they would like it. So again, these efforts really reinforced our strategy to try and enhance our programmatic efforts and our outreach efforts to students, and trying to identify ways early on, you know, before they start school on campus, and what are those risk factors? Who are the students that we need to be reaching out to ensure that they're getting this information?
I think this question of culture is an important one, and I wonder if I could throw a question to the panel, I suppose, at the risk of airing a little of Walsh's own dirty laundry, right? We made an attempt. We had a group of students who was very active and very committed, and they did their data and worked very hard to try to get our dining hall to go trayless, thinking that that would both reduce food consumption, but also reduce resources being used, particularly water, to wash the trays. And I will say, in defense of the administration, we were in favor of it, supportive of it. The dining hall manager was supportive. President was supportive, the students got their data together, and it was the students themselves who didn't care for it. And so I wonder if the panel might comment on changing a culture, particularly when those you're trying to address, and the ones who are using the services are the ones who might be the most resistant.
Yeah, I'd like to respond to that. So we made a change to trayless back in 2008 now. This was before I actually worked with dining, but I was a student at UCI. And one of the things I think that was done well, or cleverly, was the change was made at the start of an academic year. It was made, you know, kind of summer, it was planned, and it was rolled out for fall. So there you didn't have necessarily everybody up in arms that suddenly something was changing, whether or not it was good, you know, right? They don't always like to see the change happen to something that they're comfortable with and is kind of part of their home. The dining halls are really very much a part of the home feel of the freshman living communities. So I think that's part of it. And then also touching on the point that was made kind of before, just in generally about culture, I think it's going to vary a lot campus to campus, how you best address issues such as, you know, the guilt or the shame that the students might feel utilizing these resources. Sharing an example from UC Santa Barbara, when they implemented their food pantry, initially they had a lot of issues with that utilization, with, you know, people feeling uncomfortable. They kind of changed it up, revamped it a little bit, and made more of a kind of a shopping experience, you know, for people that went in, so that they could feel more normal, you know, going in and using these resources, not feeling that they were some kind of second class. And so I think that that certainly, you know, from what I've heard speaking with the administrators there, that went a long way. So.
I think another piece of culture is also knowledge and awareness. I think we see that in students who go out to the community and they work with food insecure populations, you know, they suddenly realize that the people they thought were hungry were not the people they thought. And they suddenly have this greater recognition for the issue and are personally invested in the people, and they have a reason to be committed to it. And I think, you know, making that personal connection to an issue and involving all of your departments, this is a really cross-disciplinary issue. You know, hunger is important in all these departments. You know, the history of food and in campus ministry and sustainability, and tapping into students in all of these different departments and finding what they care about and kind of the source of their passion, and then connecting that to this issue is really important.
Question up front here.
One of the things that I think is the diffuse nature of this. When you think about in the overall debate that's going on globally, there's a lot of issues raised about the waste problem versus the yield problem. And yes, if we could somehow get everybody to be wasteless, then we wouldn't need more yield. Well, the argument is that it's hard to change people's behavior. And as you have, but what I think is one of the really great impacts of what you're doing is the education that you're providing. You're creating now in our systems an ethic about how to use resources, which I think is incredibly valuable, because in the long term, it's going to be your generation that's going to really be faced with some of these problems, and you're going to need broad-based support to actually make these kind of things happen. The only thing that I take away from what you said is that it's interesting. I live in Washington, D.C., but we have a house out in Maryland in a rural area. And the town itself has a small college called Washington College, a small liberal arts college. I'll get to you on the small liberal arts. And so the community is highly democratic, and the rural surroundings are highly Republican. And what's interesting is that there's a whole culture around food and art in the town that is so dynamic and involves so many people that there isn't the tension that I feel in our less integrated societies between the two, because they talk about other things. They're interested in the food they eat, they're interested in the art that they... So the solution, and Tom Friedman talks about this, many of the solutions to breaking down the barriers that I talked about occur at the local level, and they occur around things as fundamental as food. And so what you do in your actions at the local level have really, in an integrated sense, have the ability to affect us as a nation. And so at two levels. So I think this is a very important discussion, because I'd love to see a generation that really thinks about, I mean, I grew up in riding in the front seat of my dad's car, looking out the window, standing up. And I never thought I'd ever wear a seatbelt. Well, of course, I get into a car now today, and I automatically buckle my seatbelt. You really have this aspect of changing behavior is really, really important. And you're right at the forefront of that with your efforts. And I congratulate you.
Thank you.
Okay, so I have more of a comment, but sort of looking at this from a holistic view, everything that we've been talking about in the past panel, and this one, talking about qualitative data and behavior change. Behavior change is such a difficult thing to do. Actually, for us in this room, college students are more malleable. They're more easy to change their behaviors because they can sort of think about these problems and they're ready to act. And, you know, if you tell them a statistic, just like you and I was the same, Ruthie, we hear about these things and we're like, oh my God, I have to do something. And you dedicate yourself to it going forward. But individuals who have other problems going on, you know, older people in the general public, they can't just do that. And it's a lot harder to change their behaviors. So somebody said, it takes a lot of disciplines. It's a multidisciplinary approach. All my public health people here will totally understand this. There are models out there. There are theories out there. There are sort of roadmaps to how you can change behavior, but also just how you can help people out that have a problem. So I would encourage everybody to make sure that you talk to your epidemiologists, you talk to your public health professionals, and they can design programs that are really based on theory, based on years and years of research as to how you can change a behavior. Things that we've talked about, collecting data, doing getting qualitative data, those are parts of this. And so here at Walsh, what you guys didn't do, perhaps, is user testing. It's a really important part of the sort of model of changing behavior. If you don't user test, now you've done all this investment, and you go out, you implement the program, everybody's so happy, but it falls flat because you didn't ask. So there's a lot to go into it. So I would just sort of caution everybody here, and, you know, make sure you take that into account as you move forward with your programs.
And we have time for one more.
I just wanted to say, if we all did some kind of heat map on campuses, right, to figure out what actors and what players are talking about, the same issues we're talking about today, we realize that we're touching on a very small sector in academia. While we have food, everybody eats food, we do realize that the actors and players come from institutes themed around food, hunger, but there's not a lot of inclusion of other disciplines in how we design programming, in how we design intervention, and all of that. And it'd be interesting to know if there is some kind of impute. It was very interesting to know that Tyson has a degree in English, and he's doing all these amazing things. But it'd be interesting to know what kind of interdisciplinary efforts were included in how we address hunger, especially on campuses. And now this comes up because, not to blow our horns here, the Institute just kicked off a Dean Scholar program where we have interdisciplinary students paired up in peer-to-peer mentorship situations, and they are given free hand to come up with solutions addressing hunger on campus and outside campus too. And we have people paired up, you know, for example, someone from music, paired up with someone from history in the history department, trying to solve all these problems. And we did realize, you know, starting out, that people do not even understand what the phrase food insecurity means. People don't understand what the difference between food security and food insecurity are. And all this education to start with is vitally important while we try to include other people from other disciplines as well.
Great. Thank you. Any comments from the panel? Response to interdisciplinarity of these issues?
You know, I don't know, and it's an honest answer here, don't know specifically on food access and security, but I just want to offer more from a general sustainability perspective that I kind of come from. We work a lot, not only with, you know, students that are in the environmental sciences and that type of thing, who, you know, might intern with us, but we partner a lot with engineering. For instance, one of the things that we're currently working on, and actually the idea we took from University of Washington, who shared this at the HE conference last October, is on interactive or reactive digital bins that display messaging in response to items being bothered in them to help drive you know, behavior change by raising greater awareness. So that's one of the areas that we're working on. I know UC Merced has worked a lot with computer science students, actually with their reusable to-go container programs, helping do some of the programming and integration there with the CAT cards, the ID cards there at Merced, as well as with return machines that then are able to track, you know, who has them out, be able to send messaging saying, and make sure to return this so that we aren't running into, as an institution, the issue that we're trying to reuse, but then these reusables keep vanishing, which really is much less sustainable than even a regular, you know, paper-based disposable. So those types of things, I think there's a lot of opportunity, actually, for partnering across different disciplines. If I can take the moment, actually, I'd like to respond to a point that was raised by Mr. Hanser from Carnegie Mellon earlier, and address it to everyone, is that I'd actually like to propose the research arms of many of our universities, or the students who might go on to become the graduate students from liberal arts colleges at our you know, large institutions, could actually develop, and this might sound fantastical, but I really don't think it is, through clever engineering and software development, bins, so again dealing with waste, they can identify and sort the waste deposited into them to ensure that we can truly get to a zero waste system where we are not sending waste to landfills, as a way to mitigate the time impacts that are associated with waste. And I really have to thank Batasha as well for explaining some of those impacts and really how they harm our ability to provide adequate nourishment to people globally as well as here at home. You know, people in India and Pakistan, you know, rely a lot on coastal farming, which will of course be impacted as sea levels rise. People in Africa and South America and Central America will be at much greater risk for more severe and more long-lasting drought than they even already currently are, which will of course damage yields And here in North America and elsewhere, we're also seeing pests changing their regional habitats, which is of course affecting crop production as well. So really the list goes on, but I think we do have a tremendous opportunity. I'm posing this as a challenge because I like to pose it to everybody that I wanted to that is interested in the space. That we can help avert some of those, kind of doom and gloom scenarios by mobilizing the resources that we have. This is something that there is a concrete solution out there. There's technology that I think is on a path that can be brought to bear in this and then, expanded and fleshed out. So I think it's a way to act globally, but also in a sense, do what's in front of us to take that excellent phrase that was used earlier. So,
thank you, Tyson. Well, I think with the admonition that break doom and gloom scenarios, because I was thinking as we're getting ready to transition to our dinner and our keynote speaker at the Pro Football Hall of Fame, what does football have to do with hunger? Well, we have a wonderful keynote speaker who plays for the New York Jets. Was experienced with this issue, but in terms of doom and gloom, being daunted by the task ahead of us, I would just remind everyone: you're in Northeast Ohio, and being a football fan also takes a great deal of hope. If you follow the Browns, so we're going to hope that we will work together to solve hunger, and we will hope that maybe the Browns win more than one game next season. So that's the best I can do for your connection, but I'm sure, again, we have a keynote speaker. I know that Rachel's going to give us some instructions for getting to the hall, but how about a round of applause for our... Sure.
Very, very smart. All you have to do is give them a place to start, and they'll run.